A few months ago, I was engaged to perform at the 7th Annual Food Forum at the Plaza Hotel. Now, this was sponsored by the United Fruit Company, who at the time were advertising bananas. I mean it. The Plaza Ballroom was plastered around with notices that said 88. Now, that is the number of calories in a medium-sized banana. In case you didn't know it. Well, now, on the day that I was to appear, was given over to motivation research and subliminal selling, as expounded by Messrs. Vance Packard, Cheskin, etc. Well, I thought there wasn't much sense to hold forth on, say, the French art song to people who are obviously devoting every fiber of their being to selling things like soap and deodorants. So, inasmuch as I am, among other things, professor of subliminal musicology and merchandising at the Women's Schizo Marketing School, I thought the best thing I could do was to suggest a practical banana promotion through every psychological level. Well, now, I could plainly see that this had already started with these notices round the Plaza Ballroom. This is probably the oldest style of advertising in the world and was invented many thousands of years ago by that fine old agency, J. Walter Belshazzar. It is known as the writing on the wall technique. Has gone up, you have had it. Because no matter what the signs say, they always mean the same thing. They mean you've been weighed in the balance and found wanting. And you're going to want whatever they've made up their minds to sell you, which in this case, of course, was bananas. Now let's see how this can be done. First of all, the first thing to do is naturally to say, eat bananas. That will sell some people who like bananas. And then other people need a little persuading. They have to feel that they are in the swim. So to this you add a slogan like, more people eat bananas than any two fruit. This, of course, doesn't mean anything, but... But that's perfectly all right because, to quote Pierre Martineau, the research director for the Chicago Tribune, he says, and I quote, meanings can be created clearly without rationality. There has been an emphasis on rationality for 350 years, and that is no reason to continue it. This, I think, explains a great many things, don't you? I mean, things like where the yellow went. Well, in the days of J. Walter Belshazzar, that was just about all you could do as far as advertising, but then came Freud and psychoanalysis and group therapy, and on their heels came the motivation research boys who said, if you can psychoanalyze a person and a group, why not the whole buying public? So the next thing to do is to sink in the psycho fish hooks, as it were, to see at what levels the public can be made banana prone. This can be done at three levels, the conscious, the pre or subconscious, and a lower level where we are not only not aware of our ideas and feelings, and we wouldn't discuss them if we were. Ever since that was discovered, the advertisers are having a lovely time selling us. They coax us, wheedle us, make us feel guilty, build our ego, even drive us mad. And in the final analysis, if they can't make the banana suit us, they will make us over to suit the banana. I mean, for instance, take the case of the prune. They tried this on the prune, and they found that people didn't like prunes because it reminded them of some wrinkled, old, dried-up fruit and boarding houses and stingy old maids. It was all really cobwebs. And not only that, it was good for you. I mean, really. So then the Motivation Research Institute rediscovered the prune. They discovered that all these dried up wrinkles were full of health-giving vitamins and sunshine. And they packaged the prune in gold packages and ran beautiful ads with lovely girls and handsome young men all eating prunes like mad. Then after the prune became what you might call sexy and and is now known as, and I quote, the California wonder fruit. Sales are absolutely booming. Well, now, take the banana. I don't feel the public's reasons for not buying the banana is exactly the same as those for not buying the prune, do you? In fact, I think really what we ought to do is to prune up the banana. Now, there is a commercial that you all know very well. It's about a little banana dancing a hula, and it goes something like this. Eat a banana, it's very nice. Eat a banana, is my advice. It makes you so lovely and feminine. Be careful you do not slip on the skin. Eat a banana wherever you go. Don't put in the ice box, no, no, no. It'll look so lovely, it please the eye. But feel most of all, it satisfies. Without a banana, you feel so, 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 so depressed. But with a banana, you feel your best. Banana! Now, I don't approve of this commercial for this particular product because it just emphasizes the fact that there's something about a banana that isn't a prune. So what we should do, I think, is to connect up the banana with a symbol. This is known as the soft set. For instance, you know the man with the black eye patch who is a symbol for men's shirts, and then the one with the beard who's a symbol for tonic water. And then there's the whiskey ad that has a man in a blazer and Bermuda shorts sitting on a horse facing its tail. Well, the symbol for the banana, I would think, should be something very esoteric, very artistic. And so I'm suggesting a grand piano. This also has some connection with the product because, you see, a banana has 88 calories and a piano has 88 feet. So if you mix this up sufficiently in the subconscious of, say, the town hall audience, when they go to hear a duo piano recital, they will get a craving for banana splits. I'm inclined to set this commercial up in the style of a madrigal for four voices. Children. In fact, you might call them consumer trainees. The way to do this is to have one of those TV shows where all the children and young people are the good guys and all the grown-ups are the bad guys. This develops aggression towards the parents. And manufacturers have built the aggressive outlet into the product, like, for instance, the cereals that crunch, pop, and crackle and have pistols and slingshots in the carton. Now, to go on the popping and crackling cereal, I would suggest an exploding banana. Of course, Mother won't like this, but think of what fun for the kiddies. And you can always bring Mother round by inventing some new detergent called Pink Dot Ponk with the miracle ingredient No Yell, which will get banana explosions off the ceiling. Without, of course, rinsing or wiping dry. And then if you have some commercial attached, the children will learn it long before they'll learn the national anthem. And they will sing it over and over again with all the fervor of the most dedicated commercial announcer at no extra cost to the sponsor. And they cannot be turned off like a TV set. So they will drive the parents mad with renditions like this. Pollyanna's got a banana, so has Mary and Cindy Lou. Mama, mama, what a banana, why can't I have a banana too? one to shut them up. And this will bring up the banana sales out of sheer desperation. Even if it does develop a bunch of juvenile delinquents at home. Well, now, how about the person who is perfectly impervious to advertising and who has those little gadgets for turning off the commercial on their TV set? What of them? Well, for them, of course, I would suggest the subliminal cell. You must have all read about it in the newspapers, where in about 3,000 frames of movie or TV, they slip in a commercial, which goes by so fast that the conscious mind will not record it, but the subconscious will. So you see, you're being advertised to without knowing it. Now, here is the sort of ballady song that you might hear on one of those talent shows. This is a real nothing.
Contains thumbs eyes.
not. Lovely. It would have happened sooner with our purse.